to worship with us today. Mark Twain once said, "I like a good story well told. That is the reason why I am sometimes forced to retell it myself. While I may not do the stories justice, I pray that they are inspiring to each person that hears them." That is something that we're too often getting away from these days. With all of us being confined over the past year, it's been difficult that we have not been able to communicate with others like we were accustomed to in the past. Even before the confines, with the computers and technology and all that, we don't talk to others like we used to. Sometimes a story can paint a picture better than looking at the photograph. A little boy was about 10 years old. He was standing before a shoe store on the roadway, barefoot, peering through the window, and shivering because he was cold. A lady approached the boy and said, "My little fella, why are you looking so earnestly in that window?" He replied, "I was asking God to give me a pair of shoes." The lady took him by the hand, went into the store, and asked the clerk to get her a half dozen pair of socks for the boy. She then asked if he could give her a basin of water and a towel. The clerk quickly brought them to her. She took the little fellow to the back part of the store, and removing her gloves, she knelt down, washed his feet, and dried them with a towel. By this time, the clerk had returned with the socks. Placing a pair upon the boy's feet, the lady had purchased for him, she also purchased a pair of shoes. She tied up the remaining socks and gave them to the little boy. She patted him on the head and said, "No doubt, my little fella, you'll feel more comfortable now." As she turned to go, the astonished lad caught her by the hand, and looking up at her face with tears in his eyes, answered her question with these words, "Are you God's wife?" Wow. You know, I wish I knew who wrote that story. I really do. I'd like to give them credit for it. But I wonder if it was intentionally left anonymous to know to the reader that God was in the middle of it all. I think that we might all be better off if we strived to be asked a question. Maybe not, are we God's wife, but are we God's children? Should that not what we all be, what we all strive for? Let us pray. Our kind and most gracious Heavenly Father, we just thank you for this opportunity that we have to be in your house this morning, to fellowship with one another, to learn how we can live our lives in accord with your word, so that as we go out into the world, that we may be asked by the actions that they see, that are we your children? For it is in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Mike.
Thank you, Scott. Good morning.
Good morning.
Good to see you all here, and you can see we're taking a few more steps to anticipate the warmer weather. It felt like it's already summer out there this morning. That was hot. I mean, is that normal this time of year? Here, that's normal? Okay. It's still not as bad as Texas, but I noticed it was pretty warm. So we've got air conditioning on, and we'll let that circulate and keep this temperature reasonable. But as we get started, we're going to sing all three verses of Shine, Jesus, Shine. We'll have the words up on the screen. And hopefully starting next week, there's a chance we'll have all the bulletins back in the pews, and you can open those up as well and follow along. But this morning, let's stand if you're physically able as we sing all three verses of Shine, Jesus, Shine.
Lord, the light of your love is shining in the midst of the darkness, shining. Jesus, light of the world, shine upon us.
John chapter 8, verse 12, Jesus said, I am the light of the world. But in Luke chapter 15, verse 18, he also said, I will set out and go back to my Father and say to him, Father, I have sinned. This was as he was telling the parable of the prodigal son. The prodigal son's return home. You remember that story? And in that parable, the father of the prodigal runaway son, what posture did the father have when he welcomed that prodigal son back? Do you remember?
Ran.
He ran to meet him. He ran to meet him. Listen, there's nothing we do that the Lord doesn't know about. So it's no surprise to him that we make mistakes, we fail, we trip up. The beautiful moment doesn't come from living a perfect life. Nobody can do that. The beauty comes when we turn back to God. When we go back home to Him and we run back into His arms. We're going to sing just the first two verses of Lord, I'm Coming Home. It'll be up on the screens or in your bulletins. Lord, I'm coming home. Wandered far away from God. Now I'm coming home. You can remain seated as we sing. Remembering Jesus on the cross. I don't know what emotional response you have to imagining Jesus on the cross, but for me, it's gratitude. For me, it's love, because I'm told from the Bible, from the Word of God, there's no greater love than that a man should lay down his life for his friend. Speaking, of course, of Jesus, and that's exactly what he did for us. But more than a friend, who were we before Jesus but enemies of the cross, unfortunately? More love to thee, O Christ, more love to thee. Hear thou the prayer I make on bended knee. Philippians chapter 1:9. This is my prayer, that your love may abound more and more. Remain seated as we sing all three verses.
Thank you.
Thursday, May the 6th, was observed as a national day of prayer in this country. And as Christians, we know the power that comes from being able to pray to God the Father through the Son, Jesus Christ. For us, every day is a day of prayer. Over the last year and a half, this congregation has placed a renewed emphasis on prayer. And I believe that every day we see examples of God working here in this place. On the night that Jesus was to be betrayed, he went up into the Mount of Olives with his disciples and he prayed. I'd like to read to you from the book of Luke, chapter 22, verses 39 through 44. And he came out and went, as he was wont, to the Mount of Olives, and his disciples also followed him. And when he was at the place, he said unto them, pray that you enter not into temptation. And he was withdrawn from them about a stone's cast, and kneeled down, and prayed, saying, Father, if thou be willing, remove this cup from me. Nevertheless, not my will, but thine be done. And there appeared an angel unto him from heaven, strengthening him. And being in agony, he prayed more earnestly. And the sweat was, as it were, great drops of blood falling down to the ground. As we come around the table, we recognize and we realize that Jesus is the reason that we're here. Without his birth, his life and ministry, and without his death, burial, and most importantly, his resurrection, there wouldn't be a reason to be here. So as we prepare our hearts for communion with prayer, let us thank a loving Father, a loving God that sent a willing and obedient Son to carry out his plan for us, that we might be reconciled to him and that we might have everlasting life with him and through him. Let's pray.
Bow with me, if you will. Heavenly Father, we do thank you this time for Jesus, our Savior, the one whom you sent to the cross to die for us. And Heavenly Father, what a great and wonderful sacrificial lamb he was. He lived it out for you to honor you and your will and wish. And Father, just now I pray that as we partake of the loaf, his broken body, the cup, his shed blood, may we do it in remembrance of him for all of your love also. Keep us. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Morning, brothers and sisters in Christ. Thank you for being here with us this morning to have gone through the remembrance of our Lord Jesus Christ. At this time, we no longer pass the plate because of the COVID. We have a basket in the back where you can drop your tithings at any time before, during, or after the service. Thank you all for being here, whether it is in person, on CD, or on the Facebook page. This morning, well, the last time I was up here, I talked about one of the many charities that we donate to. This week, I'm going to go back into the Bible and read a few verses on that have to do with tithing and where it comes from in the Bible. In Genesis 14, 18 through 20, it says, "Then Melchizedek, king of Salem, brought out bread and wine. He was priest of God Most High, and he blessed Abram, saying, 'Blessed be Abram by God Most High, who delivered your enemy into your hand.' Then Abram gave him a tenth of everything." Also in Genesis 28, 20 through 22, "Then Jacob made a vow, saying, 'If God would be with me and will watch over me on this journey I am taking, and will give me food to eat and clothes to wear, so that I return safely to my father's household, then the Lord will be my God, and the stone that I have set up as a pillar will be God's house. And of all that you give me, I will give you a tenth." In Exodus 35, 20 through 21, it says, "Then the whole Israelite community withdrew from Moses' presence, and everyone who was willing and whose heart moved them came and brought an offering to the Lord for the work on the tent of meetings, for it is its service, and for the sacrifice garments." We love the Lord, we praise the Lord, we give with a willing heart, because that's what we want to do, not because it's what we're expected to do. Children 5 and under will be with Betty Turner today. Children above 10 that have not received a coin with the armor of God on it, I have a few more if you would like to see me after the service. Have a very blessed and grateful day.
Thank you, Tony. I tell you, I like the rotation we have for child care, and of course now, not only is Miss Betty Brewer taking care of the kids right now, but she has also volunteered to babysit the pastor's kids, so the pastor, minister, and his wife can go out for their anniversary dinner later today. So we're gonna do the Olive Garden, because we're real creative like that, okay? Somebody asked me where we were going, and I said, well, we go to the Olive Garden, and part of that is because we moved so much, we knew there would be an Olive Garden everywhere we moved to. So we enjoy that, and I appreciate everything that everyone does here, and especially with the kids, and going down and watching them and participating throughout the week. Especially thinking of Miss Betty today, as she's going to pull a double shift with kids today. So keep her in your prayers. All right, well, we are finally going to wrap up this sermon series on evangelism, where we've been asking the 6 journalistic questions: who, what, when, where, why, and how. So we didn't take them in that exact order. That's just the general pattern, right? Well, 2 Timothy chapter 4, verses 1 through 5 is going to answer the question, when? When should we share the breaking good news that there has been born to us a Savior for us who are sinners? There is a Savior for our sins. When do we share that good news? All right, we've answered how we do it. What we say, what we do, who we are sharing it with. We've gone through all of those answers. And next week we're going to start a new series that basically speaks to the vision of our church specifically. Every church, every body of believers, whether they've got a building or not, Every body of believers has a specific niche and vision for what God has called them to do on this earth. And we've been in discussion as a congregation and a leadership team to say, what is our vision? Where is God leading us as a church? And we're going to start getting into that next week. Really, over the summer, we're going to take time to talk about the vision of this church. It'll be a good opportunity to get some feedback if there's a ministry that God's laid on your heart or something that you'd like to see the church do or that the church has done. The trick there is, we're a church working with limited resources and limited people. We don't have a million people at this church yet. I don't know if you'd want to attend here if there was a million people. I saw some of you look around when I said that, like, please, no. But we're blessed to have who we have here, aren't we? Amen. So the question is, what do we do? Not what do we theorize, what do we talk about, what do we do? Well, out of everything we discuss, one of the most basic things we can do is tell other people about Jesus. That's why we've been talking about evangelism. And not just talking about it, we're also practicing evangelism. We're actually talking to people. I've asked you for a couple weeks, it was in the bulletin before I ever got here, and that was, who is God calling you to reach out to? Think about one person's name. Reach out to that person. That's what we're talking about. Well, let's go ahead and jump into our passage. If you don't mind, as a sign of respect, if you're physically able, would you mind standing with me as we read the Holy Word of God? 2 Timothy chapter 4, verses 1 through 5 on the screens and in your bulletin. In the presence of God and of Jesus Christ, who will judge the living and the dead, and in view of his appearing in his kingdom, I give you this charge. Preach the word. Be prepared in season and out of season. Correct, rebuke, and encourage with great patience and careful instruction. For the time will come when people will not put up with sound doctrine. Instead, to suit their own desires, they're going to gather around them a great number of teachers to say what their itching ears want to hear. They will turn their ears away from the truth and turn aside to myths. Finally, verse 5. But you. Now you keep your head in all situations. Endure hardship. Do the work of an evangelist and discharge all the duties of your ministry. You may be seated as I pray. Heavenly Father, we need your truth in our lives. Thank you for your word, which is your truth. Now, Lord, we need help putting it into practice into our lives, not just into the memory bank of our lives, but Lord, in the activities and events and actions of our lives, may we continue to broadcast you, to preach you, to talk to others about you, to share you. Lord, you've already given us the courage we need. Be patient with us as we obey your call on our lives. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. You know, I'm always a little bit sad when I read 2 Timothy. Because as far as we know, this was the last letter Paul would have written to his son in the faith. All right, now where's Paul at when he's writing this letter? He's in prison, right? He knows his life is coming to an end. Why has he been in prison? Well, because neither the Jews or the Romans care for the trouble he's causing by telling people about Jesus. And so Paul's coming to the end of his life. He knows it's about time to pass the baton. But when we're talking about biblical discipleship, it's not that a leader passes the baton to the second leader. It's that the disciple maker passes multiple batons to multiple other disciples. Because discipleship is about growth. It is about multiplication. Right? There's not one straight linear succession of leaders. This is about creating multiple men and women of faith capable of leadership and moving the church forward. Well, Paul, though, has put special attention into Timothy. Paul worked with many, many men and women of faith, but specifically he's focused on Timothy here. And in this first statement, we're going to get the frequency with which we should tell other people about Jesus. Here, remember what he said. He said, in the presence of God and of Christ Jesus, who will judge the living and the dead, and in view of his appearing and his kingdom, I give you this charge. Preach the word in and out of season. In and out of season. In other words, whether it's comfortable or not, whether it's popular or not, and we got to admit, looking back on this nation's history, some here can remember a time when the church was more respected in the community, right? Do you remember a time when the church was more of a central component to the community? Can you remember a time when it was expected that you would show up at church whether you wanted to or not, because that's just what you did? Who can remember when it was the church that was the main grounding point for every powerful thing that happened in the community? Who can remember that? Well, I can tell you, I don't remember that. Now, I was blessed to grow up in church, and I've seen churches get by with barely doing anything in their community, and I've seen churches go overboard doing a lot of stuff in their community. I've seen everything in between, but it's had to have been an effort on the part of the church to step in and create that space. Whereas before, there was an expectation, we need churches to build an essential community. There was already a space for churches. We don't live in that time anymore. And there's nothing wrong with that. The church, the early church, the first church, wasn't built in a place where there was already a space for a church. That space had to be created. The pioneers had to blaze the trails and settle areas for the church to grow. So we are not quite in the same shoes as the early church, but I'm just saying this is nothing new. This is in our DNA as sons and daughters of God, those who have been redeemed by Jesus. It's in our DNA to have to go out where there's not a space for us and create a space. There's nothing wrong with that. And if you say something about the good old days, my first question is, were the good old days actually all that good, or is that just because they're a memory? A lot of the days are what we make of them right now. It's what we make of them. Times are always going to be hard in one way or another. I really don't know that there is such thing as good old days. And I know you're saying, I'm not going to listen to some 32-year-old punk kid tell me there's no such thing as good old days. I get that. But I'm going back to the Bible, right? I'm going back to the Bible. And there's always going to be sin in the world. There's always going to be sickness in the world. There's always going to be death in the world. And there will always be a movement against God's truth in the world. So we're not experiencing anything new. But what's the frequency here? In season and out of season. And I understand this letter we're reading was written to Timothy. Okay, I get that. Paul, under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, writes down these words in a letter to Timothy and sends them off. But let me ask you this. Doesn't Paul, also inspired by the Spirit, say that every single bit of God's word is useful for reproof and instruction and training, right? So I believe this is for us too. This is for us too. Preach in season and out of season. You already know the answer to this. Do you need a microphone and a pulpit to preach? No. Some of the most effective preaching is done from parents to children, from Sunday school teachers to children, from co-workers to another co-worker. That's some of the most effective and powerful preaching, because you're living life with people. People trust you, and when you speak a life-changing truth, the people who are living life with you are going to listen. I'm just here to encourage you. My job is not to save people. My job as a minister is to minister to ministers and equip you to go out and evangelize. Now, I'm still evangelizing, but that's not my primary job. Otherwise, you would call me an evangelist. Training for evangelism is a part of what I do, and I do evangelize. But you are going to be the most powerful influence to turn families to Jesus Christ. I'm just here to encourage and send you out. That's always been my job. And you need to be ready to preach the word in season and out of season. That doesn't mean you carry around a laptop with a 3-point sermon. That'd be really obnoxious, right? You meet somebody for coffee, and you bring out the laptop and put it on the table and say, all right, I've got a little story here I want to share, and I've got 3 points. So I can tell you right now, I'm going to get the coffee, maybe even call the police and leave. Right? So you know what I mean by preaching. Preaching, when we say preaching, we put a lot of baggage on the word. We say, hey, don't preach at me. Okay, well, what preaching should be is motivating and encouraging each other into growth. That's all preaching is. And I bet you do it half the time without realizing it. Someone comes to you with a problem, and immediately you're trying to think of ways to encourage them. That's in the vein of preaching. What we're talking about here with evangelism is encouraging people a little bit closer to Jesus. Well, have you prayed about that? Do you know what God says about that? Would you be okay if I shared a verse with you that's really encouraged me? Did I tell you, I wrestled with that stuff too until I came to know Jesus as Savior? See, that's preaching. You're not delivering a sermon. You're sharing what Jesus is doing in your life. We all need to be prepared in season and out of season. Now, Paul spares no detail in the content here either. He doesn't just say, preach in season and out of season. He's going to go into more detail. And I thought about making a sermon on this alone. Why? Because there's 3 points. Every minister loves 3 points, right? 3 points in a sermon. You've always heard, it's 2 bits and a what? Oh, come on. 2 bits and a shave, right? Am I saying that right? I can't believe it. Ronnie, you were there. You saw it last night, didn't you? 2 bits and a shave, right? Well, for a what?
You just
got
2 bits.
For a minister, it's 3 points in an invitation. All right? 3 points in an invitation. So there was 3 points here, and I thought I could build a sermon off of this, because Paul says, correct, rebuke, and encourage with great patience and careful instruction. Correct, rebuke, and encourage. That would make a wonderful sermon. Very simple, very easy. Offer corrections in season and out of season. Deliver rebukes in season and out of season. And offer encouragement in season and out of season. The problem is, if I did that, then I'm taking those 3 little thoughts, I'm going to yank them out of their context, out of the encasing cover that's built here in this passage. I'm going to yank those out, and I'm not going to have an exegetical message where God's word was allowed to do the talking. I'm going to be performing what's called eisegesis, where I've got some of my ideas, and I'm going to put them on the Bible. And if we're going to evangelize, we can't do that. All we can do is be a mouthpiece for the Bible. Let the Bible speak for itself. Encourage people to go look at the Bible for themselves, to read it for themselves. We don't want to make disciples of us. We want to make disciples of Jesus. So let's turn them to His words. So when Paul says, correct, rebuke, and encourage, this is all back in the context of preaching in season and out of season. So Paul's saying, it is never a bad time to rebuke somebody. It's never a bad time to encourage somebody. In other words, if you look around and people are saying, hey, you can't talk about this topic right now, all right, you'd be considered a bigot. Paul says, I don't care if it's out of season, you still talk about it, because if a situation calls for the word of God, calls for some evangelism, calls for us to share some good news, we've got to do it. We've got to do it. That's not my job. My job is to encourage you to do that. And together as brothers and sisters, we're all doing it. Does that make sense? I know you know the drill. I'm not teaching you anything new. I know that. But I'm just reminding us, because we live in a climate right now where we are scared to say the wrong thing. Or we go the other way and say, I don't care if it's the right thing or wrong thing. I'm just going to bulldoze everybody. And then we're like, how come nobody listens to me when I talk about Jesus? Well, it's because you're being a jerk half the time. That's why. I think that's why Paul says, it's never out of season to encourage. Let's just be honest. When you showed up this morning, did you feel like you wanted me to rebuke you? Do you want me to rebuke you this morning? Or do you want me to encourage you? We all need rebuking from time to time. We all need correcting from time to time. If there's anyone here who thinks they do not need correcting or rebuking, then let's start there. Get over yourself. We all need correcting and rebuking. We're always growing. We are told that our faith is not complete until we're at home with Christ. In the meantime, we all need correcting and rebuking. But I'll tell you what we need. We need what Jesus said. He said, those of you who are heavy burden, give your burdens to me and I'll make your burdens light. That's encouraging. That doesn't mean everything becomes magically perfect. It means it becomes manageable. We can breathe enough to appreciate life, even under the strain of life. So I do want to encourage you. We've got to be faithful doing this in season and out of season. Romans 8:31 says, if God is for us, who can be against us? That means if we are telling other people about Jesus out of season, when it's not popular, when America doesn't center a lot of its activities around the church, when we have to create a space for ourselves out in the world out there, there's not one sitting around for us. Even when we do that, God says, if God's for us, who can be against us? Right? If God is for us, who can be against us? We're also told that the gates of hell will not prevent the growth of his church in Matthew chapter 16, verse 18. Even if we have to create a space, it is ours to take. We need to invite ourselves into the lives of other people. Growing up, I remember inviting myself to people's homes when I was 8 or 9 years old, because I would find out from my friends during Sunday school, I would ask who was having what for lunch. I didn't realize I was a preacher in the making even then. And I would pick the best meal. And then I would take those, remember the little cards we used to hand in, the attendance cards or prayer request cards, right? You know what I'm talking about? Well, I would pass one of those cards to my friends. Can you invite me over for lunch? And they did it every time. And I learned I basically had a menu at my disposal. And I would invite myself to people's homes. Now, it led to some good friendships and, jumping bikes off of ramps and all this other fun and playing with cars and, whatever. It led to some good times, but I was inviting myself into their space. That's very rude. But I always had a good meal on Sunday. Now, if the folks were going to Pizza Hut, the family would go to Pizza Hut on Sundays, then all bets were off because we go to that Pizza Hut buffet, right? But otherwise, I was inviting myself into people's homes. That's a part of what this evangelism is we are trying to join people for dinner. We are trying to invite them over to our house for dinner. We're going to go share a meal. We're going to break bread. And we're just going to sit around without pressure, without structure. And we're going to share the good news of Jesus Christ in season and out of season, whether it makes for a popular opinion or whether it might actually isolate you. In season and out of season, we've got to continue sharing the word. Because Paul warns, he says, they will turn their ears away from the truth and turn aside to myths. Do you see that right now? Do you see a lot of people turning aside to myths? Now, that word myth is interesting as we wrap up here. That word myth is interesting because it doesn't say all-out lies. Here's the trouble with myths. Myths can contain a little bit of truth, even from Christianity, and still lead you straight to hell because Jesus isn't involved. Jesus is not the center. Jesus is not the exclusive. It's Jesus plus something. Or it contradicts the Word of God. That's a myth. It may sound good. It may work for other people in their minds. But unless it centers around Jesus Christ and is based off of His Word, it's a myth. Do we have millions of people following myths today? Do we have people? Could you go to a Christian bookstore and find false preachers in that Christian bookstore? Yes, you could. You want a list of names? I've got them. I've got a list of 32 guys and gals I would not recommend. I've also got a list of 32 guys and gals I would recommend. They're out there. We've got to be careful. That's why we have to be in the Word. That's why we have to be reminded of the gospel, and that's why we need to share it, because even those who've grown up in church might not be saved. Let's finish on a good note. Just like Paul did with Timothy on this thought, on this specific thought, this specific passage, Paul ends on a good note. He just said, hey, you've got to preach in season and out of season because things are terrible. People are turning away to myths and there's all kinds of false teachers out there. So you need to keep doing your work. Do all your work. Preach in season and out of season. Discharge all your duties as a minister. What does that mean? That means if you find yourself surrounded by people who are lost, you now have a responsibility as a minister of the gospel of Jesus Christ to tell them about Jesus. It's that simple. Discharge all your duties as a minister. That means you're making yourself available to tell people about Jesus. You're creating space and opportunities. You're taking advantage of opportunities to tell people about Jesus. When you get to the end of your life, you won't be there at your funeral. It's not going to matter what people say about you. That doesn't get you into heaven, right? We all know that. What's ultimately going to matter is, did we faithfully follow Jesus? Were we telling other people about Him? Were we turning back to Him when we needed to turn back to Him? Were we walking right with Him? Ultimately, are we covered by His blood? That's the bottom line. And here's the good note. Paul's talking to someone covered by the blood of Christ, a minister just like us. He said, but you keep your head in all situations. Endure hardship, do the work of an evangelist, discharge all the duties of your ministry. Normally, if Paul said something, he was addressing a specific issue. So I've got to wonder, does that mean that Timothy didn't always keep his head in all situations? Does that mean that Timothy didn't always endure hardship? Does that mean that Timothy, maybe like us, didn't always do the work of an evangelist? It's a very personal encouragement. I want to pass it along to you. We need the reminder. Let's keep our head. I know the world's kind of crazy out there, and I know we feel like it's hostile to the Bible, and it's hostile to God, but we've got to keep our head, endure the hardship, and just do the work of an evangelist. And what's that? That's taking the seed of the Word and just sowing it out there. You remember that message, right? You remember that? Sowing the Word out there. That's what we do. Let's keep sowing the Word, telling people about Jesus, pointing them to the Word. So I don't know what God's saying to you this morning. But as Mary and Vivian come up to play our song of invitation, I want you to meditate on what's said here in just a few verses after our passage. 2 Timothy chapter 1, 7. God has not given us a spirit of fear, but of power, love, and a sound mind. This is right after Paul said, keep your head, endure all things, knock out your list for ministry. He says, God's not given us a spirit of fear, but of power and love and of a sound mind. And James 1:12 says, blessed is the one who perseveres under trial, because having stood the test, that person will receive the crown of life that the Lord has promised to those who love them. Love Him. We're going to talk more about our vision next week as a church. We're going to start on that. But this week, as we finish talking about evangelism, answering those questions, who, what, when, where, why, and how, when it comes to the when, the answer is all the time. Every opportunity we get, we need to tell people about Jesus. We need to share what He's done in our lives. During the song of invitation, I know I've got a habit of taking my microphone off and going to the back, but I do intend to stay up here. And if you have a decision or something you'd like to share or a burden on your heart, you can come forward. You can remain, if you wouldn't mind, if you're physically able, would you please stand as we sing our song of invitation? Verses 1 and 3 will be up on the streets and in your bulletin. Now I belong to Jesus. Time for invitation.